it's been a kind of a drought here in this area for a while, and so I'm sure that we're all thankful that there is a little rain to come and water our yards and things like that. And it is a blessing that this water is coming down and saturating everything. And I mean, if you think about it, it's really God that provides this water for all of us, that God lets it rain here and provides good things for His creation. But I'm going to talk to you today about a different kind of water. It's a water that Jesus spoke of when He was talking to the woman at the well. Being a Jew, went and spoke to a Samaritan woman. And in that day, in that culture, that was like just something unheard of. And it was just, they didn't do that. The Jews were very lofty. They thought that they were better than the Samaritans. And they just didn't really associate with the Samaritans. And so for Jesus to go and associate Himself with a Samaritan woman it was just unheard of in that day. And so it really shocked a lot of people. But when Jesus, in John chapter 4, it tells us what He did. It says, now when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard, when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that He was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus Himself did not baptize, but only His disciples, He left Judea and departed again for Galilee, and He had to pass through Samaria. So He came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as He was from His journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. And Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For His disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. But the Samaritan woman said to Him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked and He would have given you living water." The woman said to Him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and all the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it Himself, as He did His sons and His livestock." Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water, welling up to eternal life." And the woman said to Him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." The water that is coming down from the sky right now, it'll go away. Now we get this water for a little while to water our crops, to water our fields, to water our vineyards, and to water our yards and plants and things like that. But there is a water that never goes away. And all of us, to some degree, are searching for life. We are searching for life in all sorts of things. We're searching for life in our maybe even in buying things, or our job, or our family, or our, you know, just whatever it is. We're searching for life. We want to have a sense of joy and a sense of just life. But Jesus here, He goes on, and He doesn't stop at this water that will, you know, that the woman would drink and would never thirst again. He goes on to say, He asks her a question. He says, "Go find your husband and come here." The woman answered Him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is your husband, is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to Him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. Your worship, you worship what you do not know, but we worship what we know. For salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship Him. God is spirit, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and in truth. The woman said to Him, I know that Messiah is coming, He who is called Christ. He who comes, He will tell us all things. And Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am He. As He spoke to this woman, this Samaritan woman, about all these things, He spoke to her about her sin. He spoke to her about her adultery. She had gone out and she had been seeking her satisfaction in men. She had been seeking her value in men, her life, as it were, in men. She sought her identity in men. And Jesus is saying to this woman that you are drinking from an empty well. You know, and the thing about it is this thing relates to us as well. It doesn't matter if you're a woman seeking your identity in men. It doesn't matter if you're a man seeking your identity in the pleasures of women, or if you're a person just out, you know, and seeking all your identity in the things that you have, or the career that you have, or how high you get raised up on the totem pole in your job, or whatever it is. That is drinking water from an empty well. And that well, it will leave you empty always. But Jesus said there is a water that you would drink of it and you would never thirst again. You see, He was trying to tell this broken woman, this sinner, this adulterous woman who had been broken and sought all of her value in men. He was trying to tell her that she's going the wrong way. That she needs life, that she does not have life. You see, we have all committed adultery in our hearts by looking at love. We've all, you know, lied and stolen and done all these wicked things in our hearts. And we are seeking our value in other things. The Bible tells us in Romans chapter 3 that no one seeks for God. The cause of all humanity is that no one seeks for God. You know, God has put us in this world. Romans 1 tells us that He created this world, this irreducibly complex universe, in such a way that we would look around and we would recognize that there is a God. The Bible says in Romans 1 that we suppress the truth of God because of our sin in unrighteousness. Romans 2 tells us that the law of God is written on every man's heart. It tells us that our conscience condemns us in a way that's clear to all people to see. All people know it's wrong to lie. We all know it's wrong to steal. We all know, you know, deep down that there's a God. That's why there's an atheist that rails against the Christian when he begins to tell them a message of life. That's why an agnostic, you know, they suppress this truth. That's why all these different, religions, they're seeking their to worship even dumb idols, the Bible says. You know, idols of wood and stone and things like that. You know, things that are not living. But there is a living God who created the world. And He created this world in such a way that we were, if the Bible says in Acts chapter 17, if perhaps we might grow for Him and seek after Him. But I ask you a question. What part of your life is seeking after God? Is there this sense in your life where you're really seeking after God? Or are you just continually going on in your daily life without this, you know, just a flippant, you know, not even thinking much about God and just kind of going through your life, you know, doing that? And I ask a lot of people, you know, what is your purpose in life? Why do you go to a job every day? Why do you do all these things? And most of the time people tell me, well, it's because I want to take care of my kids, or it's because I want to do well in life. But the thing is that is not why we were created. We were actually created to glorify God. And we're, the thing is, when we're doing all these things, we're not seeking to glorify God. What's up, man? You got something to say, or I'd be willing to talk to you. So the thing is that as we live our lives, the Bible tells us that no one seeks for God. And that's what I want to ask you today is are you seeking for God? Because if you're not seeking for God, then what are you living for? You're working on your day of death. You're living this life preparing to die. You're just building up all this wrath and things like that. You know, living, chasing after wind. The Bible says that this life is but a vapor, that it's here for a little while and then it's gone. Are you striving after the wind? Are you striving after vanity? The Bible says in the book of Ecclesiastes that this life is fleeting. And this life is, it translates the word vanity, but it's better translated fleeting. This life is but a vapor. It'll be here for just a little while and then it's gone. So I'm asking you, what is it in your life that you're doing of true value? Are you seeking after, you know, just to store up wealth, or are you seeking after the one true God who has a well of water that if you drink of this well, you will never thirst again? We are guilty before God. We have sinned. And the greatest plight of all man is that we have not sought to know our Creator, although He has revealed Himself. And I want to ask you today to think about it. And I want you to turn from that sin of not seeking to know God. And I want you to turn to the living God who alone provides joy and life and legal satisfaction for sin. You see, you are going through this life, if you're not in Christ, you're going through this life, as it were, like with the axe of Damocles hanging over your head at all times, waiting to drop. And the moment you die, you come into judgment. And so I'm asking you to consider these things today, to turn away from your sin and turn to the one true and living God who is Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Jesus made an exclusive claim. He claimed to be God. He claimed to be God who had come down and wrapped himself in human flesh. And then he went, humbled himself. The Bible says, taking the form of a bondservant, not counting equality with God a thing to be grasped, not counting it robbery. And then he went and he died on the cross. And on that cross, he bore the wrath of God, the hatred of God towards sin. The Bible tells us that God hates sin. It also tells us that there's a sense of hatred towards the sinner as the sinner goes on. Psalm 5:5 says that in other texts. And so there's a sense of hatred towards the sinner as the sinner is walking in rebellion continuously against God. But yet God still pities mankind. He still pities mankind, and He desires, as it were, that mankind will come to Him, because He is a benevolent God, but He's also a just God. And so one day that justice and our God is going to come down, and God is going to come down, and we'll all come to judgment. And we're not out here today to be self-righteous. We're not out here today to condemn, as it were. Because Jesus said, I did not come to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through Him. And so we're out here today not to condemn. Because who are we to condemn? We were dead in our sins. But we're out here today to give you life, to let you know about the Son of God who came and died on a cross, bearing the wrath of God, who lived the sinless life that you and I could never live. And on that cross, there was a swath. Jesus Christ took on our sin. And if you trust in Christ, then you become a partaker in Christ's righteousness. You can get Christ's righteousness, a righteousness not of our own. You see, our guilt leads us in such a way that we will never be saved unless we have someone else's righteousness. We need His righteousness. And His righteousness is the only righteousness that will ever get us to the Father. So Christ lived the righteous life that we could never live, a sinless life. And then He went and died on the cross, bearing the hatred of God towards sin. He drank down our hell, as it were. The holiness of God, the hatred of God towards sin. Christ drank that down on the cross. And then 3 days later, He rose again from the grave, overcoming the power of sin and death, so that all who trust in Him, so that all who would turn away from a life lived for self, and all who would turn to a life lived for God, all who would come to Him in repentance and faith. The Bible says repent. Jesus said that. It means to change the mind. It's a Greek word, metanoia. The changing of the mind leading to a change in action. And so, the Bible says to turn away from your sin. That's what repent means. It means to change your mind about yourself, that you're not good. The Bible means to change your mind about self, that you are a sinner. and that you are a vile sinner before God, before a holy God, and to change your mind about God, who he is, that he is holy and just and righteous, and that he does not look on the wicked with favor, that he cannot look on the wicked with favor. And turn to him and see your need, and run to him in faith and repentance. A true saving faith is a faith that bears forth the fruit of works. Let's not be hypocrites. Let's not try to, pretend like saving faith is just, a flippant offense to God. True saving faith is a change of heart. It's where God is, if you've had an encounter with God and he's changed your heart, there's a change. There's a radical change. Have you really had an encounter with God and there's no change? And so cry out to God. If you're not saved today, I would say that you need to cry out to God to save you and turn to him in faith. God bless you and thank you for listening.